So I'm here to give a very, very short talk on exploring the universe. And as we will see, the universe is very, very large. So we cannot explore much of it. What I will do is I will give you two very short snippets on things. One which is of current interest, so current that something is going on right now. And another which has built up over the last 2.5 decades. So first, I'm sure most of you know, all of you would know, that astronomical objects are very, very large. The smallest astronomical bodies of interest are like asteroids or comets. They have a large range of sizes, but the their scale essentially starts around 10 kilometers or so. So bigger comets are around 10 kilometers across. Asteroids can be anywhere between a few hundred meters to a few thousand kilometers across, and so on. Earth, the planet we live on, has a radius of 6,400 kilometers. The largest planets that we know of, not in our solar system, but around other stars, they can be as large as 1 lakh kilometers across. And stars can have diameters which are about 1,000 times larger than that. And the largest objects, which are galaxies, which are groups of billions of stars, they can be up to 10 raised to the power 21 meters, which is like 1 lakh light years across. Okay? So these are the sizes of objects. And now I will come to typical distances between objects to give you an idea of the scale of the universe. So distances between planets in our own solar system are of the order of 10 to the 8 kilometers. Okay? So that's like 100 million kilometers. And the distances are about 10,000 times larger than the Earth. So if you compare these two scales, you find that planets are very, very tiny. And they are separated by a very large distance. So if I want to make a model of the solar system, and I use a ping pong ball to represent the Earth, and I keep it here, the next planet would be somewhere in sector 9. Okay? So even though astronomical objects are very large, and there are many of them, they are very far apart from each other. And the space between them is almost empty. Not completely empty, but almost empty. And if we talk about distances between stars, then nearest star to us is around 4 light years away. And typical distances between stars are 3 to 4 light years in most parts of the universe. Galaxies, which are like 1 lakh light years away from each, 1 lakh light years across, the distances between nearest galaxies is like a million or a few million light years. So the summary of these two slides is that the universe is really huge and astronomical objects are very huge, but even within them, the range of sizes is huge. For example, comets are only about 10 kilometers across, but our own galaxy is 10 to the 17 times larger than that. Okay? So I will talk about two objects today. One is comets, and the other is about the universe as a whole. So this is a picture of comet Kohoutek, which was visible. This picture was taken more than 30 years ago. This came into the inner part of the solar system in 1976. And it has the characteristic form which we associate with comets. It has a bright head and it has a longish tail. Now I told you that comets are around 10 kilometers across. How can something which is 10 kilometers across look so big? And the answer is that what is looking so big is actually diffuse gas and dust which is thrown out of comets. The nucleus is only 10 kilometers across, but this tail can be millions of kilometers long. So one interesting name given to comets is visible nothing. You can see it. But the density in the tail of a comet is smaller than the best vacuum created on Earth ever. Okay. So what is the mechanism? How does this dust get thrown out and so on? Now, if you talk about comets, then there is one very famous comet, Comet Halley. This was the first comet for which it was realized that it comes into the inner solar system again and again. It has a time period of around 76 years. And the last time it came in the inner solar system was in 1985, 1986. So the next time it comes will be in 2061. So the younger ones of you will certainly be around to see it. I should add that the last visitation was one of the poorest in terms of visibility of the comet. I tried very hard and just about managed to get a glimpse of it two or three times through a telescope. But many programs were launched at that time, and one of these was a spacecraft launched by a European space agency called Giotto. Giotto was a painter, and he had painted Comet Halley in one of his paintings. So to commemorate that, they called the spacecraft Giotto. And this spacecraft was sent very close inside the head of the comet. It was sent very, very near the nucleus. So this picture which you see over here of a dark potato-like object was taken from a distance of 500 kilometers. Many of the instruments in the spacecraft were damaged because there was a rain of things being thrown out. The resolution here is not very good, but those of you who have access to internet, I suggest you go look for this picture, a high resolution version of this picture. And what you can see is that there are jets being thrown out of the comet. How are these jets being thrown out? The understanding which was developed after these pictures and other data was collected, that the surface of the comet is actually very dark. Okay? It's much darker than the surface of the Earth. And as it comes close to the Sun, the comet heats up. And as the surface heats up, any gases which are frozen when the comet is in the outer part of the solar system, they begin to evaporate. And as they evaporate, pressure builds up inside, and almost like a volcano, it throws out material. On Earth, when there is a volcano, the material falls back on Earth because Earth has strong gravity. Comets are very tiny. The gravity is practically non-existent. So this material is lost forever. So it is thrown out at a few kilometers per second. The escape velocity for the comet is a few meters per second. So it never comes back. It just escapes. And that is essentially what gives rise to this glorious tail. Okay? So after this mission, which was sent in 85-86, a lot of data was collected and people learned a lot about comets. But it was also clear that a close approach to the Sun is not a good time to look at a comet, because it is doing all kinds of things. It is throwing out all kinds of things. And you need to worry more about safeguarding the spacecraft rather than actually doing science. So people came up with a very interesting idea that we will launch a spacecraft which will go and land on a comet when it is far away from the Sun. But if you want to do that and you want to have the encounter when it is far away from the Sun, one major problem is that you need to travel a long distance to get there. So it was a very ambitious program, which was approved in early 1990s, launched in 2004. And this year, it made a close approach to this comet. Again, a European Space Agency project. So the mission is called Rosetta mission, started in 2004. It's still going on. So it consists of two parts. One is the large orbiter, which you see, which will make the journey. It will get into an orbit around a comet. Now, if you understand dynamics, to be able to get into an orbit around a comet is in itself a very thrilling thing. It's a very exciting, very challenging thing. And then, at some stage, this orbiter will drop a lander onto a comet. So the small object which you see a little lower down, that is a lander which is supposed to land on the comet. And when I said that this is of current interest, the final go-ahead for the lander to land was given 6 hours ago. I will show you a couple of animations of how it is supposed to go. But these are animations. By tomorrow morning, the real pictures will be available. The real movies will be available. This, incidentally, is a picture of the comet. And you can see that it is a hard object with very jagged kind of edges all over the place. It doesn't look like an astronomical object. Why? Because we are used to seeing astronomical objects which are round. Astronomical objects are round because most of the astronomical objects which we have seen in detail are very massive. They are so massive that if I were to build that kind of an object with a crystal, the crystal structure will be crushed. So if I try, for example, on Earth, the tallest mountain is Mount Everest. If I artificially try to build a mountain which is higher than Mount Everest, no matter what material I use, I will not be able to build anything which is taller than 15 kilometers. Because gravity will simply crush it. It'll overcome all the interatomic forces which lead to the structure. I mean, you can think of taking this tower and adding one more on top and adding one more on top. But as you keep on adding these, the weight of the upper ones is on the lowest fellow. And you can ask, how high can I go before the lowest one gets crushed? And then plug in the values for strength of the strongest material that you know of. And you will find that the answer is of the order of 10 to 15 kilometers. And because the comet is much smaller, much lighter, gravity does not smoothen its shape. That is why it is so ragged in shape. So it shows the lander coming out of the orbiter and dropping towards the comet. And the second movie shows approaching the landing site. So all of that has happened. The second snippet which I wanted to talk about was at the other end of scales. This is the universe at very, very large scales. Now the expansion of the universe, you may have heard that the universe is expanding and the rate of expansion is accelerating. The expansion was discovered about 80 years ago, 80, 90 years ago, and the acceleration was discovered around 15 years ago. But in order to understand the universe, a lot of effort has gone in the last two decades on trying to observe, measure, and quantify distribution of galaxies. And the most important contribution here has come from the Sloan Digital Sky Survey. So what you are seeing over here are galaxies which have been imaged and their distance is estimated in the Sloan Digital Sky Survey. We sometimes find that galaxies occur in tight groups, many of them together. One just passed by. I will go back and play that. So you will notice from the right there is a group. We call it a cluster of galaxies. This is approaching. It has a large number of galaxies very close to each other. And when we pass it, there are hardly any galaxies nearby. So the distribution of galaxies is extremely uneven. There are parts which are almost empty, very large. These are called voids. And there are field galaxies in filaments and sheets. And there are small groups of galaxies, tens of them. And there are also clusters of galaxies which may contain as many as a few thousand galaxies together. So the interesting thing which we have learned over here from this sky survey and other sky surveys is that the distribution of galaxies is very non-uniform at small scales. But as we go to larger and larger and larger scales, the distribution appears more and more uniform and the universe is extremely smooth. So this shows the overall distribution. Now I don't have one here, but I could have shown you a movie from some of the simulations of galaxy formation that we do, which also contain exactly this kind of structure. So the remarkable thing is that using theoretical models and comparing them, matching them with observations, we have been able to refine our models to the extent where we can match the observations in great detail. Now this is credits. The Sloan Digital Sky Survey was originally funded by the Sloan Foundation and later on joined by around 30 universities, and they executed it together. This incidentally is the year when European Space Agency is celebrating their golden jubilee. So this is a picture of the lander leaving the orbiter and gradually going down towards the comet. This operation was started about 1 week ago. As I said, the gravity of a comet is extremely weak, which means it's a highly fine-tuned operation with which you go down closer to the comet, get rid of your motion, and land softly. And you certainly want to avoid any hard, jagged edges which are there all over the comet. So this is the later one as we approach the landing time. So this is with the, these are pictures with the zoomed in camera. So you can see the orbiter gradually sinking towards the comet. So these pictures were available a couple of days ago. The final instructions to land on the comet were given about 5 or 6 hours ago, and the landing should happen anytime now. So here it is, two snippets, one from very small scales. Comets are only around 10 kilometers across. The other from very large scales, the distribution of matter in the universe, which is the largest scales which we can see, and where we can tie up our understanding of the universe with Einstein's theory of relativity. So I will stop here. Thank you, with just a brief message to all the teachers and students. ISER Mohali and all the other ISERs run a basic sciences program. So students, if they are interested in science, should think of coming to ISERs. And teachers should encourage students who are seriously interested in science to come to ISERs. It's a good program. It comes with a fellowship. And the atmosphere and the overall program is quite exciting. Had I been a student today, I would have definitely joined this. At the same time, if the students are not sure if they want to do science or not, do not send them here. Because in academics, the road is very long. And for someone who is not very sure, it could become an arduous journey. Thank you. Yeah, the question is, since the comet is so small, how hard is it to locate it and land on it? The European Space Agency itself has made a promotional video where some future generations of humans are talking about something, and then they refer back to this mission. And they are saying that the technology was such that they might as well have used a slingshot. So it's an extremely tough ask. If you, for example, compare with Mangalyaan, where we have sent an orbiter to go around Mars. There we know the mass of the planet very precisely. We know the orbit very precisely. And because the planet is not terribly far from Earth, we can locate our spacecraft fairly precisely. So the exact amount of engine firing or rocket firing which has to be done to get into the orbit can be calculated with reasonable amount of surety. Here there are simply too many uncertainties. So what they relied on instead was a variety of instruments which allow them to do ranging with the comet. These are essentially radar-like instruments which allow them to do ranging with the comet. And once you get close, you use that instead of anything else to finally get into the orbit and to land. So the last two months which were spent before the lander was released was essentially to understand the gravity of the comet.
Sir, my question is that whoever astronauts are, वो स्पेस मिशन के लिए जाते हैं तो उनको कई तरह के फिटनेस टेस्ट से गुजरना पड़ता है अपने आप को फिट प्रूफ करने के लिए तो क्या
सवाल समझ नहीं आया जो एस्ट्रोनॉट जाते हैं उनको क्या करना पड़ता है
कई तरह के फिटनेस टेस्ट पास करने होते हैं तो क्या आप उन टेस्ट के बारे में कुछ बता सकते हो
तो क्या
किस तरह के टेस्ट उन्हें पास करने पड़ते हैं स्पेस मिशन पर जाने से पहले
नहीं बात समझ नहीं आया एक बार फिर से बोलो जरा
ही इज आस्किंग व्हाट काइंड ऑफ फिटनेस टेस्ट डज एन एस्ट्रोनॉट हैव टू टेक Before going on a mission.
ठीक है तो जो फिटनेस टेस्ट होते हैं वो जो फाइटर प्लेन्स होते हैं उनके पायलट्स वाले जो फिटनेस टेस्ट होते हैं उससे थोड़े ज़्यादा मुश्किल होते हैं जो फाइटर प्लेन होते हैं उनमें आपने मेनूवर अगर देखे हों कोई अगर एयरफोर्स का एयरपोर्ट आसपास हो आपके घर के या स्कूल के तो वो लोग कई बार बहुत टाइट मेनूवर करते हैं बहुत शार्प टर्न करते हैं अब आपने देखा होगा कि आप पत्थर को रस्सी पर बांधिए धागे पर बांधिए उसको घुमाइए तो आपके हाथ पे जोर फील होता है ना, होता है कि नहीं होता है? आप अगर बाल्टी में पानी लें या छोटे से मग्गे में पानी लें और उसको जोर से घुमाएं तो पानी नहीं गिरता है, क्योंकि उस पर सेंट्रीपेटल फोर्स लग रहा है। तो अगर एयरप्लेन बहुत शार्प कट लगाता है, शार्प मोड़ मोड़ता है, तो पायलट को उतना एक्सेलरेशन हैंडल करना पड़ता है, और एक्सेलरेशन को जो एक्सेलरेशन ड्यू टू ग्रेविटी है उसके यूनिट में मेजर करते हैं, नापते हैं कि मैं 5G तक हैंडल कर सकता हूँ या 8G तक हैंडल कर सकता हूँ। तो जो एयरक्राफ्ट होता है उसमें रॉकेट में ऊपर जाते समय एक्सेलरेशन बहुत ज़्यादा होती है और काफ़ी वेरी करती है। तो फिटनेस इसलिए चाहिए कि आपकी बॉडी का जो ब्लड सर्कुलेशन सिस्टम है या और कोई सिस्टम है वो उतनी एक्सेलरेशन में रप्चर नहीं कर पाए, कर जाए। आपका सिस्टम रोबस्ट होना चाहिए, यानी कि आप टफ फिजिकल एक्टिविटी के आदि होने चाहिए।
गुड इवनिंग सर, आई एम प्रमोद फ्रॉम मिजोरम। सर माय फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन इज जनरल, द आई सर टू एंटर इनटू योर इंस्टीट्यूशन एंड व्हाट इज द एडमिशन क्राइटेरिया, डू यू हैव स्क्रीनिंग टेस्ट एंड व्हाट मिनिमम मार्क एलिजिबिलिटी फॉर एंट्री इनटू द फर्स्ट ईयर, दैट इज माय फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन। एंड माय नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन इज एकेडमिक regarding the theory of origin of the universe. I'm very curious about there are some one of the latest theories, that string theory, sir.
Yes,
I'm not very clear with that concept, so at least I can explain to my students, because one of my students asked me, sir, can you explain about string theory?
Right.
Then I said I have limited knowledge, so I will find out and tell you. And the third question is about dimension. As a layman, we are very familiar with only three dimensions, length, breadth, and height, and as little concept of time and space we have. And beyond that, in the theory of origin of the universe, there are multi-dimensions, even 12, 24 dimensions I highlighted. Can you just elaborate in short about this, about my questions? Thank you.
So I'll start with the first question, which is the easiest one. So there are three channels of admission to ICERS. One is what is called the Kishore Vaigyanik Protsahan Yojana, or KVPY. It's a scholarship scheme of the Government of India, and it is run by Indian Institute of Sciences. If you are a KVPY scholar, then you can pretty much walk in. Admission is guaranteed. The written test for KVPY is held in October or November. Application forms are asked for in July, August. Students can take the test in class 11 or in class 12.
Okay, sir. Thank you very much. I am Fayaz Ahmad from J&K. Many questions are arising in my mind. I will ask a few of them. One of my questions is, if you please tell me something about origin of time. And another question is, what provides the uniformity to the comets, asteroids, stars in the universe? What is the force behind them? And one more question is, what makes the comets to fall down on the Earth? And do all comets fall on the Earth, or they escape from the Earth? Thank you, sir.
Okay, so I will start with the last question first. Comets typically do not fall on Earth. Some do, but that is a very rare event. And the last time something fell on Earth, which was fairly big, was about 100 years ago, and it fell in a place called Tunguska in Serbia. So most of the comets do not come anywhere near the Earth. They may be orbiting Sun, and they come in and go out on their orbit, but it can be a coincidence that when they are doing so, they pass very close to the Earth.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Then the other two questions are much harder. I don't know how much time I have, but so I think there is. I'll be eating into the time of the last speaker. So maybe we can take it up in a discussion outside.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, and thank you very much.